you an update on all the work that has been going on at the DuPont site, as well as what you can expect in the future. So I do have some slides prepared. Some of them have already sort of been spoken to, so we'll go through them rather quickly. The first slide that I have just shows the DuPont site in relation to the zones of Superfund work. Zone 3 there is the Riley Park site, Riley Park neighborhood. And as you can see, the DuPont site's northern boundary is right alongside of Zone 3 there. The next slide gives you a view of the entire DuPont River Corrective Action site, all 440 acres of the site. That dark snaking line that you see towards the bottom of the slide is the Grand Calumet River, and that is the southern boundary of the DuPont site. So one of the questions that was shared with me is a question about why this is a river corrective action site and not a Superfund cleanup site. And before I speak to this, I would like to let you know that there's a handout up front that explains this in a lot more detail, so you can feel free to take that with you as you leave today. But there are a couple reasons why this is a RCRA corrective action site. And the first is that DuPont submitted a RCRA permit application back in 1980 for the generation and storage of hazardous waste on their property. So that was their beginning into the RCRA corrective action program, with an order then being signed in 1997 for the investigation and cleanup work at the site. So since 1997, we started our investigations, and we've been moving through the RCRA corrective action process over time. The next slide speaks to a little bit about the difference in our cleanup programs, and quite frankly, the two cleanup programs function very much the same way. We have different terminology that we use, but we work through the cleanup process very similar. RCRA uses a RCRA facility investigation as our first step in the process, where we look at the site as a whole. We look at the processes that were on the site, what kind of chemicals were used, what kind of chemicals were produced at the site, where they were held, where they were stored, where the releases could have been, what was released, what were the concentrations, and that's done over the course of time, and we do a lot of sampling in conjunction with that. We had two RFI reports that were out in 2002 and 2004 that detailed all of that initial investigation work that went on. That's called the RI in the Superfund process. So then we moved to the corrective measure studies, which is similar to the feasibility study done under Superfund. In our corrective measure study, we begin to look at options for cleaning up the problems that we've noted on the site. What kind of options are available to us? What kind of treatment technologies can we use? And we begin to look at that in the corrective measures study or corrective measures proposal, sometimes it's called. We did receive an initial corrective measure study back in 2006, and we had an addendum as early as, or as late as 2016 to our corrective measures study. And where we are right now, which is part of the reason I'm here today, is to let you know that we are very close to releasing our statement of basis document, which is a proposed remedy for the DuPont site. The statement of basis document will be released sometime this fall, in conjunction with a 30-day public comment period, where we will be actively seeking your comments on the proposed remedy for the site. And following that, after the public comment period, after a public meeting that we will have, after we review each and every comment and respond to each and every comment, we will issue our final decision under RCRA, which is similar to the ROB under Superfund. And you should know as well that RCRA and Superfund work very closely. We've been coordinating on all of these efforts, both the RCRA site and the off-site work, and we will absolutely continue to do so. So in conjunction with that, I mentioned a public meeting. That was one of the questions that was presented to us, is will EPA have a presentation on DuPont? Aside from the information I'm sharing with you today, we will absolutely have a public meeting as soon as that statement of basis document is released. It is still undergoing final review internally in the agency, and we do hope to have it out this fall. And so when it is released, we will have that 30-day public comment period where we can seek your comments, and there's many ways that you'll be able to provide those to the agency. One of the ways will be at a DuPont-specific public meeting that we will have, where I will fully explain the proposed remedy, answer your questions, and at that time be able to take all of your public comments. Additionally, I will be preparing a fact sheet,
In fact, she will summarize that larger statement of basis document, and I will be directly mailing that out to the government officials, environmental groups that have expressed interest, the community groups that have expressed interest, as well as direct mailing them to all of the Rowdy Park residents. If any of you here today would like to make sure that you're included on that list, we will have a sign-up sheet. You can give me your contact information, and I will make sure that you receive that fact sheet when it's ready to be released. So another question was about the contaminants of concern present at the DuPont site. And again, this is what the statement of basis will address when it is released. We predominantly have arsenic, cadmium, lead, and zinc in the soils, and arsenic in groundwater. And this makes sense based on all the investigations that we've done out at the site. One of the main products produced at the DuPont East Chicago site was an insecticide called lead arsenate. Two main ingredients, a part of that are lead and arsenic. So the logic holds there is based on what we saw produced at the site, that's what we're finding out in the soils and groundwater. I did want to specifically say that PFOS and PFAS are not site-related constituents of concern at the DuPont East Chicago site. PFOS and PFAS were not stored, produced, used, handled, managed, disposed, or processed at the DuPont East Chicago site, nor were they ever transported to the site and then transferred off the site. So because of those reasons, they are not considered contaminants of concern. We did get a lot of specific questions about the underground water study, about the groundwater at the site. And as was mentioned earlier, we've been looking at the groundwater for some time now. We have a very extensive monitoring well network at the site. Groundwater wells are located all throughout the 440 acres, some closer to the southern boundary, but we have at least 18 wells that are located right near that northern property boundary near the Rowdy Park neighborhood. We have most recently done some laboratory tests to look at the ways that we could treat the arsenic that we're seeing in the groundwater. And we also looked at the results from that and went on site and tried to confirm some of those results with on-site work. And those were done over the course of a year and a half from 2014 to 2015, and we saw some really promising alternatives, and we'll be laying out what we're proposing as a remedy when that statement of basis comes out this fall. The groundwater at DuPont does migrate in two different directions. The gentleman mentioned the groundwater divide that exists in a portion of the East Chicago area, and it does exist on the DuPont property. So we do have a portion of the groundwater that does migrate north up towards the Rowdy Park neighborhood, and also a portion of the groundwater that migrates south towards the Grand Calumet River. We, as part of our cleanup, we'll set cleanup standards, numbers that need to be met at both that northern boundary and that southern boundary for the groundwater before it leaves the DuPont site. The northern boundary will be the MCL, the drinking water standard. Even though no one is drinking that groundwater, that will be the standard that we will set at that northern property boundary. The southern property boundary will have the IDEM surface water standard as its cleanup goal, given that it is being discharged to the Grand Calumet River.
And I'll ask you a quick question about that.
Sure.
Is there a perch plume in the soil above the groundwater that needs to be remediated? In other words, I guess you won't know that until you finish your investigation.
We don't think there's a perch plume per se. We do have contamination in the soils that I mentioned that contributes as an ongoing source in a way to the arsenic that we're seeing in the groundwater. And as part of the proposed remedy, we will specifically deal with that part of the site. So dealing with the soils and any ongoing contamination that they could be contributing to the groundwater. And the last question that I received was about underground storage tanks, specifically at DuPont. And there were underground storage tanks, I believe there were about eight of them, but they were all filled and closed prior to 1985. We do have groundwater monitoring wells located near those areas where there were underground storage tanks that have never seen any impacts to the groundwater specifically related to the underground storage tanks. I would like to mention though that there are three still on the leased Grace property, which is located in the southwest corner of the DuPont site. Two of those hold potable water that is used within the processes at Grace, and one has been closed and is not in use. The last slide that I have here lists our RCRA Corrective Action site webpage. The site is specific to the DuPont RCRA Corrective Action site. It has all the information that you will need to bring yourself up to speed to where we're at right now. So currently, if you went to this site, you would see information on our 2014 final decision on the natural area. That was the portion of the site that was cleaned up back in 2014. As soon as this statement of basis for the rest of the site is available, it'll be up there with all the supporting documentation that you need. It'll also be available in your local public library. There is a DuPont repository there already, and we will add to that as soon as we can. It will also be available at our Region 5 Records Center. So there's going to be a lot of ways for you to be able to access the information you need. And again, I want to make sure everyone is aware that we will be back here with a public meeting specifically on DuPont and specifically on that proposed remedy so that we can answer your questions in detail at that point and also take your public comments. So thank you, and if there's more questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Yes, and questions just for clarification to understand what Jennifer, what Jennifer just told us. Yes, ma'am.
Can you explain what those PFAS, PFOS and PFAS, and also what is perch plume?
A perch plume?
Well, PFOS, PFAS are contaminants, chemicals that were found at other DuPont facilities based on the products that they produced at those facilities. One of the main products that it can be found in is Teflon. However, that product, nor any other products that... Teflon, yes. Or fire-suppressant foams. There's a lot of things that it could be in. But based on the information that we have, that none of those products were used, made, transferred, stored, disposed of at the East Chicago site. Perfluoroactinoic acid. I'd say PFOS or PFAS, much easier. Perfluoroactinoic acid. I can provide a fact sheet after the meeting as well that, you know, gives some information or at least direct you to where you can find some more information on those chemicals. But the main point of emphasis here is that they're not at this DuPont East Chicago facility.
Over here.
I'll speak to it as much as I can. I'm not a hydrogeologist. At that public meeting that I have specific to the DuPont site, we will have a lot more technical experts familiar with the DuPont site that can speak more directly to those specific questions. But it would be an aquifer that, or a pool of the groundwater that would be located higher up in the strata and be contributing to the ongoing groundwater conditions at the site.
Spell it perch.
Perch, P-E-R-C-H-E-D, a perch plume, P-L-U-M-E.
Over here, Jennifer.
Hi, yeah, just a point of clarification. I may not have understood clearly. You said that the RCRA process opened up in the early 1980s. Is it common that it takes over 35 years to get to this point?
The RCRA corrective action process takes a little bit longer than some of the times the Superfund cleanup processes do because of the way that our program functions. We have a solvent entity at the DuPont site. We work with DuPont and their contractors in preparation of all of the work plans and the sampling that goes on at the site, as opposed to Superfund cleanups where they have Superfund contractors that go out and do the work. There's a lot more negotiation, and it usually takes a lot more time to go through each step of that process. Additionally, this was a pretty large site, over 440 acres, so we did take time to make sure that we were clearly understanding the conditions. Another point of clarification was the groundwater issue that we had with the groundwater divide that occurred at the site. We wanted to make sure that we understand what was going on with that. So it did take time, but we've been moving through the process step by step. As I mentioned, you know, we did come out with a final remedy for a portion of the site back in 2014. At the same time that we were doing these laboratory and on-site studies, so we were trying to keep things moving as quickly as we could by doing multiple things at the same time.
Okay, we have
here.
Yes,
good lady first.
You know, it would really be helpful if you spelled out things in the PowerPoint. Because of all these initials we don't understand, and you're really flying through some of this data. So that would be really helpful for the common person here to understand what you're talking about. We don't have to ask you what you're talking about. Now,
that's great feedback.
I have a question. My question is, are you doing any studies for oil spills? This area has had some serious oil spills, the Grand Cal River there, right by the Dugan property by Kennedy. And so there's a lot of contamination going on. Have you excluded testing, or do you, because when oil comes up, what do you do with that kind of data? Some of the contaminants you're not looking for does show up, you still record it.
If I'm understanding your question correctly, it's related to our sampling and the detection of oil, or are we looking for oil? Our original sampling would have had all of those constituents included as part of our investigation, and specifically in relation to those underground storage tanks that I mentioned. A lot of those were holding petroleum-based products, so we specifically looked for any impacts, and as was noted, we didn't see anything. But as we continue to monitor the site, if we did find those contaminants, we would follow the trail and find out where they're coming from. But to date, we have not. They're not part of the constituents of concern that we have at our site.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm sorry, Carla, you're next.
Okay, throughout your presentation, you keep making mention of the Riding Park neighborhood. You made reference to how the water flows north towards the Riding Park neighborhood. And you mentioned you're going to mail out the notices to the Riding Park neighborhood. My question is, what are your boundaries on the Riding Park neighborhood? Since the water that flows north flows throughout all of Zone 3, and even into parts of Zone 2. And yet you seem to be eliminating a lot of those residents by just mentioning the Riding Park neighborhood.
I want to make sure that everyone understands I'm not trying to exclude certain areas of the community. We would follow the contamination to see where it goes as part of our investigations. But as far as the River Corrective Action Site is concerned, we are trying to control the movement of groundwater from the river site past the boundary. And so the closest boundary at that northern area is the Riley Park neighborhood. So that's why I tie them so closely together.
When you're not talking about the neighborhoods that water would have to flow through to get to that neighborhood. Riley Park is only the northern half of Zone 3.
I think
south of Zone 3.
To be clear, what she's saying is that they're attempting to make sure that the contamination stays within the fence line, and they have a testing site that they're calling Riley Park that lets them know that stuff is still getting off the site and migrating north as opposed to not.
I understand that. He also stated that she was only going to mail out notices from the public comment to the Riley Park neighborhood. He did not conclude in that the entire area that is being contaminated. That's why I wanted clarification.
Sure. Thank you.
Well, as I mentioned, we can send them out to the larger community. If people want to leave their contact information, I'm more than happy to send them out to anyone who wants that information.
I think that folks are trying to serve this community to the best of their ability and to the best of their information flow from the community. And so if we find that we need to expand a notice and stuff like that, and just suggest that it happen. It's a mailing. I'm coming, sir. Yes, ma'am.
And my question, I live in the 49th block, the Ronnie Park area. The residents in that 4900 block, are you trying to say that you're stopping that contamination of groundwater flowing onto that 4900 block?
The remedies that we're looking at that will be a part of our statement of basis will look to treat the groundwater on site at the DuPont facility before it migrates off site, so off of the DuPont property northward, however far that goes. So we're looking at treatment technologies and ways to clean the groundwater so that it meets the MCL at the property boundary before it leaves the site.
So you're not sure whether or not contamination is in the 4900 block or in the Ronnie Park area at the end?
We know that there is arsenic levels in the groundwater currently above the MCL. We currently have an interim measure in place at the northern property boundary. It's called a permeable reactive barrier. PRB for short, you may see that in some of the documents. But the permeable reactive barrier is basically a kind of a wall that's located in the ground. It's permeable, meaning the water can flow through it. So at this time, the groundwater flows through that permeable reactive barrier. The arsenic gets trapped within that barrier, and the water coming through on the other side is cleaner. The issue that we were noting over the course of time and over the course of our study is that although the water was cleaner, the water leaving the property line was still not quite achieving the MCL. Now, that's a drinking water standard, and no one is drinking this groundwater coming from the DuPont site, but that is the level of cleanup goal that we have for the site. So we have been investigating, particularly over these past few years, 2014, 2015, how to get that cleanup to go even lower to achieve that MCL. And so that is the ultimate goal, and the proposed remedy will lay out the ways that we think we can achieve that goal.
Okay. My last question.
We're running out of time.
There's a fence that's running, I guess that's DuPont land there. Mm-hmm. So you're saying that your wall down in the ground is next to that fence somewhere?
It's not exactly right next to it. It's you know, several feet before it. So that's the issue, is that there is some contaminated soil between that wall and the fence line. So we're going to have to deal with that issue as part of the proposed remedy. But we're aware of it, and again, the goal that we have is for the groundwater to meet that MCL value before it leaves the site.
Okay, again, these are questions for clarification. We have a couple of more agenda items to get through, and it's almost quarter up. So, Larry, I'm going to defer.
You are focused on the metal contaminants, particularly arsenic and lead. The problem there is those are cumulative in animal populations. Has that actually been taken into account? I don't think the MCLs actually do.
Points of compliance at the two different boundaries of the site are different. As I mentioned, the drinking water standard is our point of compliance at that northern boundary, but at the southern boundary, we are using the item surface water standard, which is more applicable to the aquatic life at that boundary.
Let's not bring it in the invertebrate life on that point, because I could go right through the roof on that point. But what I'm saying is, these people have been exposed to this, directly or indirectly, for an extremely long period of time. Continued exposure must lead to some health problems, or can lead synergistically to additional health problems.
Is there a question?
If the question is, has that been taken into account?
Into account? For what? I mean,
for the level at which you will consider this to be clean.
So, if you've got a population that has a history of being exposed to the contaminants of concern, when you are setting the levels for how clean is clean, does previous exposure of the population at all figure into how you set those numbers?
I don't know that I could directly speak to that properly. I think that's more for my toxicologists during the public meeting to address. But I would say that your concern was somewhat addressed with the interim measure that I spoke of, that PRB, that was the whole precipice for that being installed. That was installed back in 2002. We did not want to wait around for the entire site to be completely investigated, for us to have a complete understanding of the entire remedy for the site. We went ahead and did that as an interim measure to drop the levels.
Okay, okay, thank you.
The other question is, what about the organic?
Yeah, that's good. I'm going to cut the questions off. We're going to have another question and answer period. They're all important, sir, but we're going to go on to our next agenda item. And there is, look, there's another question and answer period, Larry. No, sir. Have a seat. Grandmother, my grandmother, the turnover in her brain, if you don't feel at home.
For 13 feet per day, how is your remedy going to solve the contamination that's already flowed into the neighborhood?
I would ask you, please, don't answer that question.
So we have 13 feet a day,
but we have a room full of citizens, all of whom may want to get through the agenda.
Well, they want to be protected. How is their solution on the DuPont site going to address the contaminated water in the residential area?
Would you please hold it to the next question and answer session, period?
There you go.
Why not answer?
I'm asking you for 10 minutes. Because people
are...
No, because people have prepared to give information that was already asked for. People prepared their presentations based on what the community asked for. And I'm trying to be respectful of everybody. There is another question and answer period, sir. So let's go on and do the indoor dust sampling.